Welcome to the Thursday cross-reference episode of the Selah Time to Pause podcast from Plexus Salvation Army, an online church in the UK. On Monday, in our walk through John's Gospel, we thought about how Jesus refuses to make peace with the inward clutter, confusion and immorality of our lives, and how he desires to cleanse our lives and hearts just as he cleansed the temple. Today, we think about one extreme example of his cleansing, the story of Legion. You can read it, if you like, in Mark chapter 5.
I will stop and breathe in your presence, just breathe, just breathe.
We need rules to live by. It's part and parcel of being civilized, and different situations require different rules. Rules create order out of chaos. For me, this was most obvious when running holiday camps for young people. One of the first things that we would do after the campers arrived was to agree together a set of rules that we would all live by during the week. But the need for rules extends beyond just children's camps. For in order to function, a society must have rules that its members must mostly all agree upon, and breaking those rules may need to have consequences.
Do not murder. Do not steal. Do not lie. Do not run with scissors.
They set the boundaries for our living. These rules are necessary, but they're chains which bind us, limit our freedom and control our actions. As Christians, we believe that the rules we must live by are not arbitrary, nor are they the result of collective human wisdom or a philosopher's social contract. They're set by God, and to transgress them, to sin, has consequences. Ever since God spoke to Moses on Mount Sinai to give the Ten Commandments, indeed from the earlier days when he gave the natural law and to the later revelations as he guided his people, God's people have been concerned with following his law. This was never truer than in Israel during Jesus' time. It was then that the well-known phrase of the Jewish Mishnah became most popular, and it explains much about the Jewish religion at that time.
We build a hedge about the law.
The basic thinking was as follows. We do not want to violate God's law. If we create our own extra rules to protect God's law and we obey those extra rules, then we'll not come close to disobeying God's law. By building a hedge about the law, the Jewish leaders would be able to develop a system of rules and interpretations that would keep people as far from sin as possible. For example, if the law said not to work on the Sabbath day, they'd make up a system of rules that indicated exactly what actions constituted work. They'd be fully aware that some of those rules went further than God's law required, but by knowingly do so, they created what we might imagine as a safety zone, which meant that even with a slight slip in following those extra rules, God's law would not have been broken. They created a rule to cover every possible situation, a legion of chains for a legion of evil thoughts. We do the same today, and we do it even to ourselves. We each make up extra rules for ourselves. I make up my own higher standards that I only hold myself to and which go above and beyond what's necessary. And in doing so, we chain ourselves even further, restrict our activities and limit our freedom. Out of fear of sinning, we prevent ourselves living the life in all its fullness that Christ came to give. In the story of Legion, we come across a man whose behaviour was out of control. He would not be held by chains. His internal chains of self-control were insufficient, and so his society sought to bind him with external chains, physical restraints to prevent him bringing harm to others, and yet even they were not sufficient. Not even a legion of chains would have been capable of holding him, for a legion of lawlessness was running amok within him. The Gadarene man is a picture for us of what theologians would call total depravity. It's the teaching that, as a consequence of the fall, every person born into the world is enslaved to sin. The doctrine of total depravity goes further than saying that we all do things wrong. It doesn't say that we're sinners because we do sinful things. It says that we do sinful things because we are sinners. The Gadarene man, possessed by a legion of demons, is a picture for us of the total depravity of the human soul. A man within whom a legion, 5,000 or more instances of sinfulness dwells and is coursing through his veins. No amount of chains could restrain him, just as no amount of laws and rules and interpretations and guidelines and orders and regulations can control the sinfulness that's within the human heart. And what was Jesus' response to him? Was it to get stronger chains and bind him further? More ropes to restrict what he could do to prevent him acting upon those evil impulses that surged inside him? Did Jesus seek to shackle this man's life, manacle him hand and foot, restrain, handcuff and tether, bind up, lash down and hogtie and gag him to prevent him committing further transgressions? Was it to subdue the man where others had tried and failed? No. If we briefly take a step back, we can see that the Gadarene man's story up to this point in time mirrors the story of God's people up to this point in time also. Chains and shackles are inadequate, whether they're the Gadarene blacksmith's chains of iron or the Pharisaic shackles of a rule book. When Jesus came to this man, he needed something other than yet another new chain. When Jesus came to earth, God's people needed something other than yet another new set of rules. The solution for both was in inward cleansing, freedom, not captivity. In Christ, we are given true freedom. And yet part of our response is to impose again upon ourselves another set of rules. And it's nothing new or unique to our times. For the urge to re-religiousify our faith and to turn it into a set of laws and rules is almost as old as time itself. Christ offers to us freedom, and throughout the ages, the urge of the church has been to codify that freedom to protect us from sinning. As Christians, we ought not to attempt to produce perfect righteousness in our own lives by our own efforts. We ought not to create systems of rules and laws for us to live by so that we can live righteously. No, our hope is not in ourselves. It's in Christ and Christ alone. The freedom offered in Christ is the freedom from the desire to sin. The freedom offered to the Christian is the freedom to no longer be bound by inadequate rules which cannot save. Just as the freedom offered to the Gadarene man was the freedom to no longer need to be bound by inadequate chains. A new nature within him and a new nature within us. The life that Christ came to offer was not a life of obedience to each and every law of God, but a life that pleases the heart of God, one guided by him, growing in his likeness and ever more clearly reflecting his nature. A life of love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. The Spirit's liberty is for bearing new fruit and yielding something new in us. This is the liberation made available in Jesus. This is the result of cleansing. This is what Christ came to bring. Not an outward goodness of obedience to law, but an inner spring of godliness bubbling up in our souls. Freedom and not captivity, life in abundance and all fullness, flowing from a cleansed and purified heart, a heart which needs no chains.
If you've been walking the same old road for miles and miles, if you've been hearing the same old voice at the same old lies, if you're trying to fill the same old holes inside, there's a better life. There's a better life. If you got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom, a savior, he's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains, he's a chain breaker. We've all searched for the light of day in the dead of night. We've all found ourselves worn out from the same old fight. And we've all run to things we know just ain't right. And there's a better life. There's a better life. You got pain, he's a pain taker. Lord, he's a waymaker. If you need freedom, a savior, he's a prison shaking savior.
can feel it, somebody testify. If you believe it,